The grandfather of all modern social networks is born, based on the concept of 6 degrees of separation.
Only 6 other people. 6 degrees of separation between us and everyone else on this planet. The president of the United States, a gondolier in Venice, just... How's it funny, like Chinese water torture, that we're so close because you have to find the right 6 people to make the connection? It's a profound thought.
6degrees.com allowed users to list friends and family members. Users could send messages and post bulletin board items to people in their first, second, and third degrees. Users could also see their connection to any other user on the website. If a contact in any of the degrees of separation wasn't already a member of 6 degrees, they were invited to join. It was the first attempt ever at establishing rings of people that connect and intersect with one another. Friendster shows up, offering the standard features of sharing pictures, comments, games, and bulletin board items, but setting itself apart from others by focusing on people who already knew each other.
The new Friendster is fun and easy to use, just for you and your friends. Soon you won't only be exchanging words and pictures, you'll be sending gifts, playing games, and just have a great time with your closest friends.
It attracted 3 million users within the first 6 months of its launch. Its members were mostly happy, smiling teenagers.
Friends, because that's what Friendster is all about, connecting smiles.
Unfortunately, the smiles didn't last long. Popularity grew so fast, with no attention being paid to technology. Ultimately, the site became so slow that its membership numbers declined as rapidly as they had grown, a phenomenon that made it the subject of comedy sketches.
Last month, internet archaeologist Dr. Maxwell Fry stumbled upon the perfectly preserved ruins of an online community called Friendster.
The site was completely abandoned.
Strange.
One day, Friendster users were posting a seemingly endless stream of bulletins about awesome parties and cool shows, and then nothing.
That is
total
so
silence.
Eerie.
Today, the ruins of the site remain perfectly preserved as they were at the time of Friendster's demise, sometime around mid to late 2004 AD.
Wow. Made this amazing discovery just by looking through an old desktop's browser history?
That's right. And as soon as I entered the site, I knew I was the first human being to lay eyes on those pages in many years.
There must be so much to learn from
the Benefiting from Friendster's failure was MySpace, with its impressive technological backbone. It used real-life social and employment circles to boost virtual circles. Each one of its 250 employees was tasked with signing up 10 friends on MySpace. They targeted Friendster's users already tired of Friendster's notorious slowness. MySpace set itself apart from others by giving users complete control over the look and feel of their user profiles.
Comments. Lastly, and most obviously, MySpace has always been a place to really represent who you are with very dynamic and customizable profile pages.
Teenagers rushed to establish their online identity.
I'm a sci-fi fanatic, mild asthmatic, never been to second base. But there's a whole nother me that you need to see. Go check out my space.
And to add flair, just like AOL, MySpace too romanticized social networking.
It's the first interactive wedding where you, the MySpace audience, decides everything. The rings.
We looked for this.
The location.
Oh my gosh.
Even the bachelor party.
Totally.
Thousands of applicants sent in their submissions, and we narrowed it down to 3 lucky couples. Delia and Graham, Elsie and Joe, and Nina and Justin. Find out who wins right now in part two at myspace.com/marriedonmyspace.
By then, everyone wanted to be cool online, starting from presidential candidates and not ending with teenage stars and socialites.
Bird. See ya. Check me out at myspace.com/MileyCyrus. See ya.
Check me out at myspace.com/JordanSparks, and I will check in with you guys soon.
myspace.com/Paris Hilton. So check me out, and I'll see you guys later. Love you. Huge.
An inebriated college kid goes on a mission to hack his way through collecting pictures of female students on the Harvard campus. He then borrows a formula for comparing and ranking the girls in terms of physical attraction. He labels his web creation Face Mash and unleashes it across Harvard.
Who should we send it to first?
Dwyer.
Neil.
Who are we gonna send it to?
Just a couple of people. The question is, who are they gonna send it to?
It spread like a wildfire. After getting into trouble with the college administration, he realizes that he could take this experiment to a much larger scale. He realizes the power of social networks.
People came to Face Mash in a stampede, right?
Yeah.
But it wasn't because they saw pictures of hot girls. You can go anywhere on the internet and see pictures of hot girls.
Yeah.
It was because they saw pictures of girls that they knew. People want to go on the internet and check out their friends, so why not build a website that offers that friends, pictures, profiles, whatever you can visit, browse around. Maybe it's someone you just met at a party. But I'm not talking about a dating site. I'm talking about taking the entire social experience of college and putting it online.
There was nothing to hack. People were going to provide their own pictures, their own information. And people had the ability to invite or not invite their friends to join. See, in a world where social structure was everything, that was the thing.
And the thing was made available only in Harvard in the beginning. Then it included other Ivy League colleges, then high schools, and then it opened its doors to the entire world. The thing was Facebook. Unlike MySpace, Facebook doesn't allow much customization of user profiles. Hence, any updates on the website structure is reflected throughout the entire social network. Users are able to find what they're looking for faster since it all looks familiar. Some argue that Facebook's success could be attributed to its uniform, consistent pages. Facebook is the largest social networking website to date, with over 600 million devout followers. If Facebook was a country, it would be twice the size of a superpower.
There's an online world where I am king of a little website dedicated to me. With pictures of me and a list of my friends and an unofficial record of the groups that I'm in. Before the internet, friendship was so tough. You actually had to be in people's presence and stuff. Who would have thought that with a point and a click, I would know that Hope Floats is your favorite flick?
Harry Connick Jr.
Facebook. I'm hooked on Facebook.
By 2006, social networks had expanded to cross geographical and political borders, uniting people across the globe while dividing and conquering the internet. In their competition for hegemony, they created nearly isolated islands of social networking activity. Suddenly, a little bird comes along and tweets unity. Twitter allowed us to focus on the simple question, what are you doing right now? That's because you wouldn't create a blog or write an email about a mundane task like mowing your lawn. But you might send a short message about it. This focus was achieved through limiting the size of the message to 140 characters, thus enabling microblogging in the social networking scene.
Tweets are 140 characters or less. But there's a lot more richness underneath that. Looking at this tweet, we can see the photo it mentions, more information about who's mentioned in the tweet, and other relevant tweets tagged with the same hashtags. And I can dive deeper into any of these tweets to see more. This richness is there when you need it, but doesn't get in the way when you don't.
And everyone who felt entitled to have followers tweeted the world.
Laugh out loud at every hint of jolliness,
jolliness,
and try to self-promote without being caught. 'Cause now you're no one if you're not on Twitter. And if you aren't there already, you've missed it. If you haven't been bookmarked, retweeted, and blocked, you might as well not have existed. Oh yes, you might as well not have existed.
Twitter also created widgets, little applications to integrate Twitter with virtually any social network out there. This allowed users to remain connected and updated regardless of the social networks they were active on. Although the fight for hegemony over demography and geography raged on, it no longer mattered. A relatively small social network such as Klub in Iran plays a role as important as Qzone in China, Orkut in Brazil, VKontakte in Russia, or Facebook across most of the world. Twitter simply connected all social networks on the planet and even beyond.
I'm using Twitter to send pictures and thoughts from space. And every day, I really enjoy reading your tweets. Ciao to all of you on the beautiful planet Earth.
With Twitter functioning as the telegram of social networks, the lines between social networks were blurred, and their function shifted closer towards social media, a media through which people realized that they have common and political social aspirations. Technological revolutions enabled political revolutions on the ground. This new media allowed people to bypass state-sponsored journalism and practice their own citizen journalism.
Facebook or Twitter, it's a very good way for communication. It has no power of control from anyone. It's not like the media, like the TV, our Egyptian TV or whatever. They are controlling everything. Now there is no control. I just make a capture of any video or picture. I just upload it. It tells. Photos or media talks about itself. There is no way to fake it or anything like this. We just upload and we just communicate. We tell each other whatever we want. We don't have any other way to communicate.
And citizen journalism became in turn headline news.
I just, you know, thought this is something that, you know, probably should be seen, just because I saw that there's survivors on there, so I just took a picture, and I happened to be on Twitter, so I just did a quick tweet pic and posted it. At that point, I had 100 and some my followers, and I think within half an hour or something, the tweetpic.com crashed, actually, because of the traffic that I was getting, so it's pretty wild. And honestly, in that situation, I wasn't thinking of contacting and being a journalist. It's more about trying to save the people and see what we can help with them with.
A plane has apparently gone down in the Hudson.
That's the news. That's the news. That's the ever-loving, blessed headline news.
It turns out that strangers online can engage in a virtual dialogue that allows for the formation of a shared vision, and that chances that they all share a love for freedom were pretty high. Social networks, social media, and new media have come a long way. And in the process, they made strangers realize that they are much closer than they had imagined.